start.
Okay, so good to see you everybody here, and thanks for being here. Also, thanks Professor Kitena for giving me this wonderful chance to share what I think about the chiral light. Also, I should thank Professor Luis and Jamin Nam for making whole thing possible. Okay, so what I want to present to you today is on the argument on how we can intuitively see the chiral light and how we can use it for control of the light. Okay, so that's the reason why I titled my talk with the chirality and magnetism and biomaterials. So from my point of view, the magnetism is the key thing to induce the optical chirality. And previously, we mostly focus on the localized chiral light, but what I want to say is that that's not all. By using the chiral crystal rather than chiral particle, we can also control the propagating light as well as the localized light. Okay, so okay, let me start. So to start, let me start with what's the form of the chiral light. Okay, so to put it briefly, let me introduce somewhat different story founded in the mechanics. This slide actually took from my lecture note, fluid mechanics. So that's the stress tensor. If you are familiar with the mechanics, this stress tensor is the key thing to describe what's going to happen when the object is forced. The terms along the diagonal direction correspond to the normal stress, while the rest of them indicate the shear stress. And the key thing to see in here is that the shear stress term is perfectly symmetric. Okay, so for example, Tij and Tgi, each respectively correspond to the force for rotating here and there. And this should be symmetric, okay? The question becomes, why would it happen, right? So that's the main due to the angular momentum conservation, right? Angular momentum should be conserved, and for that, the stress tensor should exhibit some symmetry, especially along the off diagonal direction, okay? Same argument can be well implemented into the electromagnetism, right? So in 1964, some guy's name is Daniel Lipkin successfully implemented such argument into the electromagnetic theory with this elegant equation. Okay, so this term corresponds to the rotating magnetic field something as matched with the Faraday's law, and this term could be considered as rotating electric something, right? So in order to have the optical chirality indicated here, at the time he didn't call it optical chirality, he just named it certain quantity satisfying the conservation law. Anyhow, in order to have this optical chirality, we need to have the coupled electric and magnetic field as indicated here. To have the inner product after coupling between E and H for electric and H field, the key thing to have it is we need to have the deep paged electric and magnetic response between them. Okay, so I took my favorite about it. So that's what happened when the electric and magnetic response is deep paged, right? Okay, so what you can see here is that H field is more page accumulate and more squeezed, right? So what's going to happen is that electric field resulting from such diffusion from the electric and magnetic component, electric field is start to be rotated, right? So what I want to emphasize here is that in order to make the light to have chirality, we have to strongly induce the magnetic response of the light. Then we can efficiently induce the diffusion effect between electric and magnetic response. Okay, so this is quite beautiful theory, but so many people working in the electromagnetic field or electromagnetic dynamics less recognized this beautiful theory. Even himself dismissed the importance of his work, but as you can see here, something's happened in 2010, right? And 2010, as you can see here, citation number of his initial pioneering work start to increase rapidly, right? And the question becomes, what's going to happen at that time? So yesterday, as already Professor Aitzur Garcia Ixari introduced, this Gilbert theory paper is published in 2010 by the Tang and Cohen at Harvard University. At the time, they reshaped the Lipkin's first pioneering work to be well fitted at the nanoscale. Okay, so they tried to transform the initial Lipkin's theory to this equation. So even if it looks somewhat different, but the key message is exactly the same between the Lipkin's work and Cohen's work, right? So in order to have the optical chirality, we have to induce the coupling between electric and magnetic component, and that can be achieved between the via the depaging between electric and magnetic response, right? So here is the correspond to the phase difference between the electric and magnetic field. Okay, so if we have such diffusion between electric and magnetic compound, we can make the light to be rotated like that. Okay. Yeah. So the question becomes how we can efficiently induce the magnetism, right? If we have the magnetism of the material, then we can accumulate the phase of a magnetic field, and then the light can have the chirality. Okay, so this the underpinning mechanism for inducing magnetism is already well described by the Landau and Lipschitz, in their classical textbook, this magnetism theory is well described, and the mechanism is quite simple. If we have the circulating displacement current, we can have the artificial magnetism, right? And we already familiar with that argument, right? So here is the aromatic ring. If this aromatic ring is under external magnetic field, the circulating displacement current can be happen along the overall aromatic ring. Okay, but the molecular size is too small, so such a magnetism can occur extremely high frequency, right? So in order to have the magnetism at the optical frequency of interest, including visible and NIR, these molecules need to be further grown, right? So they can be achieved by using the plasma metamolecule. The reason why we call it metamolecule is like this. They can induce the artificial magnetism at the optical frequency, right? So basically, naturally occurring material cannot exhibit any magnetism, excepting very few ferrite. But if we have the ring inclusion of the metallic nanoparticle, for example, silver nanoparticle and gold nanoparticle, and once they are clustered with this kind of the ring inclusion, the circulating displacement current can be induced via capacitive coupling between each individual gold or silver nanoparticle. Okay, and as a result, we can have the artificial magnetism like that. These 2D metamolecules should be depending on the incident angle, right? So if we have the three-dimensional counterpart like that, such magnetism becomes independent regardless on the incident angle. Right, so actually we can have such a metamolecule via DNA origami guided self-assembly method. So, and once we have this kind of metamolecule, so we can see the ring inclusion of gold nanoparticle, right? And then we can experimentally see the magnetism here, right? That's the magnetic dipole. Also, electric dipole can be expected, which is can match well with the simulation or theory. Very recently, the other group proved that actually this metamolecule having the artificial magnetism can exhibit distinct optical chirality. Okay. So what I want to say here is that structural chirality is not so necessary for inducing localized optical chirality, right? So the depaging between the electric and magnetic field is the essential to having the optical chiral. Same argument also can be seen with different examples. So yesterday, the professor Aitjur Garcia-Exari introduced that the high index nanoparticle made of, for example, silicon can exhibit the electric or magnetic dipolar resonance itself without any kind of clustering and so on, right? It is a stark contrast with the plasmonic counterpart. In order to have the magnetism with the plasmonic nanostructure, we have to make the cluster, okay, made of the silver or gold nanoparticle. So that's the reason why many people got fascinated by all dielectric nano-optics over the past decade, because this dielectric nanostructure can be free from any loss problem, which has been the challenge in the field of plasmonics. Okay, so you can see the magnetic field can be strongly induced even with a single dielectric here silicon nanoparticle. Also, as introduced by the Aitjur yesterday, the CD enhancement can be also strongly induced around the silicon nanoparticle as well. And that argument has been experimentally proved by the Roman Kidant group very recently. And they used the silicon nano post, which can be defined by the result method, and they experimentally observed the CD signal can be actually enhanced. Okay. So, before going further, let me advertise our work. So previously, such all dielectric nanostructure based CD enhancement has been based on the lithographically defined solid state structure. But that's mainly due to the fact that it would be difficult to chemically synthesize high index semiconductor nanoparticle with high uniformity. But our group recently published several papers that can be possible with the selenium also having a relatively high index. Okay, so you can do some chiral study in solution phase with highly uniform and high index colloid. Okay, so at the moment, what I want to emphasize is that structural chirality is not so necessary to induce the optical chirality, but I still want to emphasize that structural chirality still can be useful. For example, as you read the rotating vector field, we can also induce the chiral vector field so that you can further boost up the chiral optic response. Also, we can distinguish the handiness of the structure. So maybe you guys in here are quite familiar with these two seminar work published by team leader in here, might be somewhere in here. Also, the other group, the Changing Wang at China, so they used the DNA origami as a template to guide the assembly of the plasmonic nanoparticle. So they can efficiently self-assemble the nanostructure with structural chirality, and as a result, they can observe strong CD signal. So from now on, what I want to say is that this particular based structure, chiral structure, quite good. Right, but they're still suffering from some radiative loss problem. Okay, so and given that, I would like to suggest some more efficient design guide rule. So recently we assembled the chiral nanostructure, plasmonic chiral nanostructure by using DNA origami. Maybe here is so many people in here is familiar with the DNA origami already, right? So by using the DNA origami as a template, you can assemble the gold nanorod with structural chirality. And you can see here is the optical chirality can be highly confined between two gold nanorod. Also, as expected, spin angular moment also well confined between the gold nanorod. That's quite good. So I'd like to introduce further is what's going to happen when they are linearized over the long chain, as you indicated in this slide, okay? So the power of DNA origami allows to do some sort of the hierarchical self-assembly, right? So what you can see here is the chirality between each golden nano rod dimer, so this chiral monomer, between the chiral monomer, the optical chirality can be well confined. It's some sort of the optical chiral hotspot. Also, spin angular momentum can be cascaded and propagating along this chiral chain, right? But amazingly, what we observed is that the chiral optical response for the chain is weaker than that of the chiral monomer, right? In this case, tested with the same monomer concentration, okay? Also, the CDP was found to be red-shifted. That's the one of the evidence the chiral monomer are well coupled with each other, right? So why would that be? That is mainly due to the cascaded loss effect. What I mean by here, cascaded loss effect is like that. Each gold nanorod should exhibit dipolar resonance. Okay? And each dipolar resonance can couple with each other with the other golden nanorod or the other chiral monomer. So such coupling should be cascaded, right? But during the electric dipolar resonance of the golden nanorod or golden nanorod particle should suffer from the radiation-mediated loss. Okay, so such radiation-mediated loss should be cascaded along the chain. This is the main reason why the chain exhibit much weaker chiral optic response compared with the monomer, right? And that loss effect could be significant for the G effect. Okay, so if we have the high loss, the G effect should become lower, right? Also, the particle-based plasma system, generally the electrical field and magnetic response tend to be spectrally detached. But in order to have the high chirality, they need to be closed with each other and coupled strong. Okay. So that's the reason why I think that very recently, as you already were recognized, the continuous chiral morphology-based single nanoparticle plasma system is well synthesized and successfully demonstrated very recently, right? And what you can see here is that this single nanoparticle without cluster and also with the chiral morphology can exhibit higher G factor compared with that of the cluster-based counterpart. Yes. And according to the report, the G factor of the continuous morphology-based single nanoparticle can exhibit higher G factor by one order of magnitude, right? Yes, so that's the reason why I do like today that continuously connected or metallic morphology is quite important toward having the high chiral optic response. Also, I would like to introduce another key parameter. It's called by Telegen, okay? And I would like to introduce the Telegen parameter in the second, and toward that, I need to introduce this category, right? So the chiral and non-chiral matter can be mainly divided and categorized into the four things as I introduced in this slide. Okay, so chiral parameter is generally represented by here copper, and the Telegen parameter generally represented by here chi. And many of you in here might dismiss the parameter over here, Telegen or chi, because most of the system discovered and reported so far exhibit extremely low chi value. But if we have the chi value, we can see the symmetric breaking of time reversal. Okay? Time reversal means that the right from left to right, when from right to left is perfectly symmetry. But in case breaking this time reversal symmetry is highly important because in order to use the light as an informative technology, the light propagation from left to right, for example, right to left should be different. Okay, but light tend to exhibit some reciprocity. So that's the reason why in these days many people got fascinated by optical isolator. But generally this chiral medium didn't exhibit the distinct chi value, distinct Telegen parameter. But what we found out that the continuous morphology based single plasmonic system with three dimensionality like the helicoid, what Professor Kitten introduced very recently, is the key to have the strong Telegen parameter. Okay, so For the chiral material, just chiral inclusion of metallic structure is enough to have the optical chirality. But in order to have the distinct telegram parameter, the electric field and magnetic field should be strongly coupled with each other. But for the case of particle-based plasma system, electric response and magnetic response tend to be spectrally detached. Right? That's not enough to have the distinct telegram parameter. But for the when the plasmonic particle satisfying these three criteria, minimize the cascaded loss effect, spectrally close the electric and magnetic response, and also volumetric chiral optic effect, we can expect distinct telegram effect. Okay? So actually, we systematically tested several plasmonic systems which has been discovered so far. So what top corresponds to the gammadion, it's quite famous chiral structure. And second row corresponds to the 2D counterpart of helicoid. And last row indicates the full 3D structure of the helicoid. And what you can see here is that for helicoid, we can see distinct breaking of time reversal symmetry. And we found out that this helicoid can have much higher chi compared with other competitive structure. So then we can have the specific chi and kappa value, right? With this chi and kappa value, we call it effective parameter. We can put it that parameter into the simulator. We can exactly extract out the effective parameter from the helicoid. So as you already know, helicoid has quite complicated morphology. It's not so well compatible with currently accessible simulation. So we simplify such a complicated morphology-based helicoid with a simple sphere, and we put some effective parameter and then run the simulation. I cannot go through in greater detail because we didn't publish yet, but we are based on the multiple expansion method. And we found out that such effective method can predict more accurate, can produce more accurate result which, compared with the experiment counterpart. So last of all talk, my talk will be will consider of the why symmetry is so breaking with the example of the chiral crystal rather than chiral particle. Maybe that can be done within few minutes. Okay. So might be many of you in here are not so familiar with what's the bimaterial. Bimaterial is correspond to the photonic or electrical material having the linearly cross-linking point in three-dimensional momentum space. Okay, so as we already know, quantum mechanics started with Schrödinger, right? And what he predicted at the time is that the particle mass of a particle becomes almost zero. The velocity of a particle or electron movement can be close to the speed of light. Okay, that's the reason why this linearized relationship between energy and momentum can be expected, right? And then 2 years later, Dirac completed Schrödinger equation with the concept of particle and antiparticle. So through this concept, we can understand why the electron can have the spin, right? Spin in particle and antiparticle should be opposite with each other. Okay, if the material is perfectly symmetric. So in this day, people say that has the parity inversion, right? So this argument also can be effective for the photonic matter. So what I want to introduce here is that there's some specific crystal with chirality. That's actually the double gyroid. Double gyroid corresponds to the triple periodic minimal surface as introduced here. And also the other important feature of gyroid is they have the chirality, okay? Specific chirality. Double gyroid is composed of the two single gyroid with opposite chirality. So what I want to say here is that, this can act as a photonic analog of Dirac's particle and antiparticle with opposite spin, right? So once we have the double gyroid, perfectly symmetric double gyroid, we can expect this kind of the photonic band structure is quite similar to what Dirac argued with the particle and antiparticle, okay? But once we break the parity inversion, by perturbing one of the gyroid, as indicated here. The structural symmetry here, parity and inversion can be perfectly break, and this bended structure can be accidentally lifted like that. Okay, so we can expect this kind of linear band structure. So actually, we obtain this expected result as indicated here. Okay, so we can see the cross-linking band point at here. What that means that we can have the topologically protected wave property of this kind of chiral crystal. So actually, we proved that the wave can propagate in one direction along the surface of the double gyroid, and due to the topologically protected feature, the light can be well propagated even this kind of surface. Okay, so here's the conclusion. What is the here is that chirality and optical magnetism is highly correlated with each other, and by using the chirality, we can localize and propagate it right. Okay, so I should thank my students working in the chiral optics. Particularly, I would like to emphasize these guys. He will be on the postdoc